Welcome back to today's episode. We're talking about The Jetty. It's a new British crime drama that premiered July 15th, stars Jenna Coleman. This is about the third series, I believe, that we've discussed with Jenna Coleman as one of the stars. The other one was The Serpent, right?
Yeah.
And then there was also The Sandman. She likes to do a lot of ones that start with The, because now we have The Jetty. But she's the main character here. She plays DC Ember Manning. Let's start off with a little game about her, though. Jenna Coleman. She was most famous for Doctor Who, right?
Yeah.
As the companion. That was where she got her big break. She actually found out about that while buying avocados, which I guess is very interesting in all the interviews that she's done. She said it several times. It's like when I learned that Thor got his job. Chris Hemsworth learned about getting Thor when he was on the set of Cabin in the Woods, which came out years after Thor.
Well, she's 38, right?
Yeah, she's 38 years old.
So this would have been in like 2008, probably. So she would have been like in her early 20s by that point.
2008 is when you think that she was in Doctor Who?
That was my guess.
No. I think she joined in like 2012, because by 2008, I don't even think Amy Pond was there yet. Karen Gillan, I don't think, had even joined the cast. But I was going to say my fact, since Karen Gillan is known for her Marvel character, don't ask me the name. It's like the half cyborg lady, right?
Nebula.
Perfect. Yes. But Olivia Colman actually predates Nebula in her character from the Marvel universe. True or false?
Olivia Colman?
Sorry, Jenna Coleman.
True.
True?
I'm going to guess that she was in like a phase one Marvel film.
Okay, she was, but which one? See how close we can get this.
Well, I don't think it was Iron Man. I'll go with the Hulk.
I'll give you a hint again. So she likes to time travel in Doctor Who, right?
Right.
So this is sort of a time travel-y movie for Marvel in phase one.
Captain America?
First Avenger.
Yeah, the first Avenger.
Yes. And who do you think she played? Because she was back in the 40s.
I mean, not the love interest, because that was Hayley Atwell.
That'd be funny.
I don't remember.
She was actually the date, I think, of Bucky in the first movie.
I don't remember her in that.
She like dragged them both. This is back when Captain America was super skinny and like scrawny.
Oh, okay. So he hadn't gone through his transformation yet.
Obviously not, because he didn't do a lot of hanging out with Bucky afterwards, unless you talk about them fighting in the war, right?
Yeah.
We're getting really distracted. Okay, so this is called The Jetty, right?
Yes.
And it's a show written and created by Kat Jones, who's done a little bit of work in other things, but like nothing of huge note until this. She gets four episodes here, and this isn't the first show that we've done that only runs four episodes.
That's why it reminded me of Bloodlands. I remember Bloodlands was four episodes.
We also did The Inheritance, which you watched the full British show for. Did you end up liking that show?
No, that show fell off after the first episode.
Right? So that's how I feel about most. Like, I think four is too short. I think it should just be a movie at that point. I think six or five can be the right zone. If you're like a Chernobyl, maybe five is perfect. But four is too short. The only four episode series that I have really enjoyed that we've reviewed is Lost Ollie. I think that was amazing.
Because that was different.
Yeah, that's different.
That was a kid's series. I think whenever it comes to drama and it is this short, except for something like Endeavor. But Endeavor, those episodes were 90 minutes. That's actually a comparison I had here.
Was Endeavor always four episodes per season, or did it get that way over time?
I think it was like three episodes for some seasons, and then others were like four, maybe a little more. I know the final was three.
So, and then Happy Valley, how many episodes was that per season?
Happy Valley, I think that was six.
That was six. Yeah. That would make sense. I really liked Happy Valley, and one of the reviews compared this to it. And because, like, so I would assume that this show as a crime drama would fit the narrative of what we've been doing a lot of this year, which is detective series.
It's right. The year of the detectives. I thought that this was
finally on board with what I've been saying this whole time.
Okay. I thought that, like, with Deadlock, it reminded me of that. Also based on a true story, but kind of the serious version.
Yeah, so it's not just that there's detective series, but this is specific to that genre that has a podcaster just infused right in the plot. And there are a lot of shows that have now done this. You just named two. But there's also from previous years, the first season, I think the first time I ever saw it done was when they tried to make Scream into a television series. And in the first season, they had a blog blog/podcast are replacing the reporter character, and she ends up being, if not the killer, someone closely related to it. So they kept the mystery alive that way.
There's only murders
only
in the
murders
building.
In the building. Yeah. Bodkin is really recent. That's the Will Forte show about the podcasters. Right. I think they go to Ireland. Truth Be Told is less of a detective series, but like a reopening of a case. It's like Serial, where Octavia Spencer is interviewing Jesse from Breaking Bad as a prisoner. It was one of Apple's first, TV series. And I think it ran two seasons, but it was about her podcast. And then Limetown, of course, was also about a podcast, which is unearthing this big mystery. This goes back to like just a regular crime thing, though. Why does a detective want to work with a podcast?
Well, that's the interesting thing, because episode 3, this is a show I assume was made for the shock value, because we start off, the podcaster is dead. Riz Samuel, the person that's hosting the podcast about Amy, a girl who went missing in 2007, she's dead. She's a lady in the lake. She has strangle scars, and she is not there anymore. And therefore, it reminded me a lot of what we were talking about last time when we did Lady in the Lake, Mayor of Easttown. It always seems like they want to start off with a dead woman, and it seems like this is what that show's doing.
So you're just saying we're doing two shows in a row, Lady in the Lake times
but
two.
But it's not just two shows. Like, every single show likes to always start off, it seems like, with like a teen woman or some type
of woman. She's not a teenager.
But Amy, the person that is, like, those are the two victims so far. Because the main question that this
episode... So Amy is the one that was dead from episode one, and
Riz Samuel.
Riz Samuel, she's the one who died at the end of episode two or at the beginning of episode three?
I think that probably was at the end of episode two.
Okay.
We were just seeing her dead body in episode three.
Yeah.
But she has been doing this podcast, or what I could gather so far, on this person named Amy, who was a girl who went disappearing back in 2007.
She went disappearing.
Well, she disappeared.
Yes.
And that was what Riz was investigating. So a lot of it is trying to figure out, is possibly Riz's death or murder connected with Amy's in any sort of way?
And is Jenna Coleman's character seem like she's on top of things, because she is supposed to be a rookie after all, but she's also training someone? Is that what I see
here?
Yes,
so Hitch isn't someone that usually goes on these missions.
Is that like her Padawan, like her number two? He's from Shadow and Bone, I think.
No, I think that he was supposed to be someone who's usually just doing a lot of like office paperwork. However, this episode, he's supposed to be going with her and trying to figure out what exactly is happening, because there's three different stories. One is she has to track a child predator. The police place is trying to figure out what's happening with Riz Samuel, and Hannah, her daughter, has been having some lewd pictures of her be leaked, and they're trying to figure out who could possibly be spreading it.
Wait, whose daughter is Hannah's? Wait, so Ember, even though the actress is 38 years old, her daughter, played by Ruby Stokes here, who's 23, so there's a 15-year age difference.
Yeah.
And she's from Lockwood and Company, blah, blah, blah. That seems, do they look like a mother and daughter?
I mean, yeah, because I think Hannah's supposed to be playing someone under 18. I think she's supposed to be playing 16.
That's even worse.
Yes, that's why we go into our main villain. It seems like he's going to be the main villain for the whole entire series, Liam Ashby. He is someone who has pictures of underage girls on his phone, and he's been kind of spreading them throughout town.
Well, where does Ember's late husband have anything to do with this? Because he's also supposed to be sort of a nefarious dude. Tom Glenn Carney.
I don't think they mention him.
His name is Malachi Mac Granger. He's Mac.
That was who Malachi was. Okay.
Yes.
So
it's interesting because Mac is 29 years old. So if he truly was the father, he would be 6 years older than his daughter. And I only point that out is because I know him from House of the Dragon. He plays Aegon. So he's the king.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And did he die in the
He was
first
also
episode?
In Dunkirk. He was also one of the main characters in Dunkirk. So you know who he played in Dunkirk? So he was, what's his face? Peaky Blinders dude. Was stuck on a boat, right?
Yeah.
And then he was saved by a couple people.
Yeah.
And one of the people who saved him was this kid.
Was it the person that made him go blind?
Made him go blind? I don't remember.
He hits Killian Murphy. Killian Murphy comes flying down, hits his head, and then
I do not remember him going blind.
Killian Murphy hit a kid, and that kid went blind, and then ended up dying later. Remember? The kid with black hair? Was that him?
No, I'm saying this was a guy on a boat. Like, this was one of his helpers. One of the people who saved Cillian Murphy's character.
Yes. Cillian Murphy.
Uh-huh.
He gets on the boat.
Yes.
There's the dad and there's the two kids.
Yes.
He hits one of the kids. The kids go flying down the stairs. Then the other kid is like, are you okay? And he's like, I can't see.
Oh, maybe.
And then later on, he dies.
Maybe. No, I do remember that now, but it could be a maybe situation. So the Jetty, though, he plays the dad and Olivia. It feels like the age ranges are just so strange to me, but you say it works.
Yeah, well, I think it works because whenever it's focusing on the case, I'm always wanting to figure out what's going to happen with the family, because there is a very big chance that Hannah, the daughter, had something to do with either Amy or Riz's death. For example, we learn on the night that it was either Riz or Amy, that whenever they died, that there was a number that was being called and they have the phone. So when they call the number, it turns out that Hannah's phone rings.
Uh-huh.
So that's where it's like, that's where the mystery really works. And at the very end of the episode, Ember has to go to jail because she was messing with evidence. And so, like, those
why,
are the
so she was trying to cover up for her daughter, or why was she messing with evidence?
It was hard to, I don't think that we really see it this episode, but I think that was just something that happened in prior episodes. But whenever it's focusing on the mystery of Riz or Amy, or if that connection works, that's kind of the bread and butter for this TV show, because that's when I was really interested in. But I felt like the side storylines were kind of when the show lost me a little bit, because as bad as it is that Liam Ashby is probably this villain for the whole series, and that he was doing this stuff with Hannah's pictures when she was underage, like kind of sending them to people, I didn't feel like
it's her step uncle, it says, so that's like grosser.
Yeah, I guess I didn't feel like it ever actually grabbed me that much.
Okay, so I'm trying to see the relations here. So Miranda, do you know who Miranda is? Oh, Miranda Ashby is a pregnant teenager. So Miranda is not the same as Hannah, right?
Yeah.
No. Okay. So, and you saw Miranda in this episode?
I don't think we saw Miranda. We see Rosie, though.
It just says Miranda Ashby, a pregnant teenager. And then it's
Miranda, yeah. So Miranda was someone that they met in the hospital that Ember was going to speak to. And it turns out that she had a baby. She has the baby, like we see it, but she doesn't want to keep it, because she is afraid of kind of what Liam Ashby is going to do to it. And she's fearful for her own life, so she doesn't want to put that onto the baby.
And how about, is there a D.I. Morgan? Because that's Ralph Ineson. He's pretty famous,
he's the police chief. Okay. And he's the person that I feel like they're going to say had something to do with the murder as well. There have been subtle hints that he's villainous. Like, there's this fly in this one scene that's really annoying Ember in the police station, and he hits it with, like, this folder. And it seems like if the show is trying to kind of give you clues as to, like, he's not completely innocent, even though he's running the investigation.
So you remember Deadlock, right? You mentioned it earlier, and how that was a very female-centric show, and the bad guy was attacking men. Was that the whole gist of it? Because they had to get all the men out on a bus and then like try to get them out of town.
Right.
It was supposed to be sort of a Me Too-ish show. This is definitely in that same vein, where it's also trying to be Me Too related. Did you get that from the penultimate episode?
But the thing is that it's all violence against women. For example, Rosie was someone that Ember was speaking to, Rosie being a woman who had scars on her neck given by Liam Ashby. And so when it's all women that are kind of at the center of these crimes, and then you have the woman actually trying to
figure
it out. Was
there any passive aggressivity, masochism, like anything, misogyny, that type of thing?
At the very end of the episode, Ember goes into this bar where there is a ton of guys there, and she kind of shames them in like this 5-minute speech.
Well, that's interesting.
Talking
so
about,
there's a random lady cop who walks into a bar and starts shaming a bunch of dudes.
Well, she's really mad because not only have all these women come through, and either they're being murdered or they're being raped or anything like that, she comes in with a ton of swabs, like those medic swabs.
Uh-huh.
And she's like, if I was a man, I would want to be clear of raping any type of young woman.
So this is like the bar in town where she expects,
and this is where
the killer to be.
This is where the Ashbys are. This is where, like, even the people that are owning the bar, there's like one woman bartender, but it's all men. And that's when she goes in there, and it was really sad because she is trying to, like, she's really giving them a lecture. She's just like, I would be like the first one in line taking the swab to prove my innocence, but none of you will, because it seems like everyone in this bar is some type of pedophile. She gives this speech, which was pretty powerful. careful. But as she leaves, that's when she gets arrested. So it was like almost confirmation bias for all the men in this bar to kind of get a lecture to and then walk out and see, oh, they kind of have the excuse to think that she's full of shit because then she was tampering with evidence, I guess. Even one of the people there was like, you know what, you should just get in the car and not try to struggle because you don't want to give these guys the satisfaction of seeing you at your lowest.
So where do you see it headed for this last episode? And do you think that people would like have, what would you give this episode?
I would give it a 6 out of 10. The reason is because it's very slow moving and there's very little times where it's actually dealing with the mystery at hand. Or anything.
So what's
that
it, what's it spending its time doing? What's it doling over? Like what's
a lot of the time is either with Hannah, kind of there's even this really random scene where Ember goes to Troy, who was a student in Hannah's class, who was getting the pictures, and she like she kind of almost beats him up. It was very strange, and it just didn't deal enough, I thought, with the most interesting parts of it, which was who killed Riz Samuel. What's the deal with Amy and Riz? What's the connection there? What's going to be happening with them? That's what the finale kind of has to clear up, and why I think the finale could be really good for this thing if it were to focus on that.
The cast on this thing, it seems like it's really, really big for 4 episodes. It's only 4 hours of content, but like there are names down here that are probably all at the bar or something, but she's also got a therapist, it looks like. You've also got the podcast interview. Like, it doesn't seem like any of this episode had anything to do with Riz, despite the fact that their body shows up at the beginning, right?
Well, they were trying to figure out how it got there. There was even a question at the very beginning when Ember runs to her mom and is like, how did you know that Riz was in the lake? Mm-hmm. And she was talking about how she was kind of speaking to Riz right before she died.
Did you get a backflash of Riz? Because she was the secondary, I think, in I May Destroy You. So you would have seen her in that.
You get a voiceover of her. Assuming.
Oh, so things, it literally is things, like A Lady in the Lake, where you get the voiceover narration.
Things she said in the podcast, I'm sure, that we saw in earlier episodes that are tying in with the overall theme of this show.
Be creepy if the podcast came out after she died, like they preset an episode like we sometimes do. Yeah,
one of the plot points is actually a lot more interesting now, because you said Malachi, right, is the dead husband.
Late husband.
Yeah, because yeah. She goes to speak to Caitlin, or I think Joan, in like this, and Joan is someone who lost her daughter. I think Caitlin might have been her daughter that she ended up losing.
Yeah, I guess you only use late husband when someone has passed away. For some reason, I thought they were more center in the series.
But the thing is that when she was asking Joan what happened to Caitlin, Joan said that Malachi killed her. And I didn't know what that meant at the time, but now we're learning that even the late husband. So it seems like what they're trying to say is that the main characters that we're following, even though you're supposed to go for them, all kind of have skeletons in their closet. Because like I said, this 16-year-old Hannah, it seems like she has something to do with the murder, because why was she being called that night that Amy went missing, or that Riz went missing?
All right. Yeah. No. So you're gonna watch the last episode then.
I'm gonna probably see what the actual twist is. Yeah, because it can't be Liam Ashby. The villain is. It would not be a twist if the villain of the series was the one who killed Riz. It feels like there has to be some type of. If I had to put my like eggs in one basket as to who it was, I would say it was probably D.I. Morgan.
The main. Yeah, so you're on the Law and Order route, where you're just taking the most famous cast member and you're saying it's got to be him.
Yeah.
So right now it has a 4 out of 5 on The Guardian. They gave it the highest, or one of the highest reviews. Some other places like The Independent have called it cliche. 6.2 on IMDb. What was the most cliche thing about it from this episode? Maybe you said it with the girl showing up dead and the amount of just women detective series where podcasters come in to help out.
Yeah.
That, what was the other series that you did recently that kind of falls into that same thing? Under the Bridge. Because Under the Bridge was based off the true story. It didn't have a podcaster, but it had the reporter lady who worked, and they
Rebecca
put her
Godfrey.
Into the show.
They put her in the show. Yes. Yeah, she's the main character.
Yeah, but at least with that, like, it was based on a true story.
Right. This is just completely made up.
Yeah,
right?
Also, Jetty is the title confused me, because I'm assuming in England they refer to peers as jetties.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out why it was called that, because it was just such a
jetties are
odd
technically
name.
Supposed to be, like, preserving of the coastline, helping more environmentally than a pier. A pier is more there for recreation or for docking of boats and stuff. Well, yeah, a jetty is more there for like the water, and it's usually built with either the rocks that are already there. But was there a jetty in this episode that you saw?
I don't think that from what we saw, no.
So the murder didn't take place on the jetty? All right, it's just a pier. It's just a really long pier. Thanks for listening. We'll see you on the next episode. Hope you enjoyed this one. Bye.
Bye.